Welcome to the Legatum Institute. For those of you who are newcomers, we are a charitable public policy think tank. Our aim is to help people lead more prosperous lives. And is this not working? to help people lead more prosperous lives. And actually, we want to redefine the term prosperity to mean well-being as well as wealth. Our annual publication, the Prosperity Index, uses a wide variety of metrics based on health and prosperity and opportunity to rank 142 countries, and it is being widely used by governments all over the world. Tonight, we are delighted to host a conversation between Danny Finkelstein and Anne Applebaum. Danny has been a leader writer, an executive editor for The Times, and also one of its most popular political columnists. For those of us who have followed his stellar trajectory, we can remember him as a young undergraduate at the LSE, where he was an SDP member who campaigned under the memorable banner of Think Fink. After that, he went into politics and worked with William Hague. And when Mr. Hague was political leader of the conservative political leader, and he's been at the Times ever since, proving so invaluable with his work there that a grateful prime minister ennobled him last year. He is now Baron Finkelstein of Pinner. Daniel's politics is actually not only learned, but in his DNA. He has written very movingly about his parents' lives and experiences, and his parents' flight from Nazi Germany, and his grandfather's internment in the Siberian concentration camps. It is their experience that has informed his political views, but that also has an echo in Anne Applebaum's book, Iron Curtain. I don't need to introduce Anne to those of you who are familiar with Legatum Institute, and for those of you who aren't, she is a Pulitzer Prize-winning author of Gulag. She is a columnist for The Washington Post and Slate, but also is the director of our transitions program. Daniel.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Christina. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'm very interested in all the work that the Institute does, but I've been very excited about the opportunity to talk to Anne about her work and to do it here. So I'm very grateful to the Garden for giving me this opportunity. Given that my slogan is Think Fink, it's remarkable, and how good that slogan is, it's remarkable how rarely people take the advice involved. One of the sort of mainstays of my political life has always been my my grandmother's saying, which was, while the Queen is safe in Buckingham Palace, we're safe in Hendon Central. And the reason that she felt that was because she'd been basically driven across the world by people with eccentric big ideas of the kind that we're going to talk about. And my father was born in Lwów, which is, when he was born, was Poland. We still have a Marshall Pilsudski clock on in my parents' dining room. by the time he died, was in the Ukraine. Some of the history that you've written about is literally my family history in your book Gulag and in Iron Curtain. We'll come on to it later, but I think the moment of Yalta, when they appreciated there was really no going home, was a very important part of my father's life. And so we'll come on to that in a moment. But I want to start, really, by asking you, Anne, when I first knew you was as a political journalist, and Now you've become a historian of really huge reputation, on based on correctly, in my view, when you read these both these wonderful books, both Gulag and the book we're going to talk about mainly today, Iron Curtain. And so I want to ask you first how it came that you took an interest in these particular topics that have formed your the basis of your historical reputation.
Thank you. It's a compliment to be complimented by you. But although I think if we continue on this cycle, then we'll take up the rest of the evening saying how wonderful we all are. So I might skip that. To some degree, I was drawn into this part of the world by accident. People usually start this question by saying, how did you become interested in Eastern Europe? And then I have to do the embarrassing thing of saying that I was a pretentious teenager. My favorite writer was Nabokov. I decided to learn Russian in order to be able to read it. And to this day, although I did learn Russian, I still can't read it because Nabokov's too hard. He uses very hard vocabulary words and complicated grammar, and so to this day I can't. The more important experience, though, is that I lived in Poland in the late 1980s and early 1990s, working as a stringer and then as a journalist, writing about the events of that year. And I know some of the people in this room were there at the time. It was a very, to watch the very end of that system, to watch how it crumbled and the different ways in which it fell apart and the bravery of people involved in overthrowing it it was an experience I never got over, and I'm still in some ways trying to explain it. Both of my two books have been, in a way, so I watched the end of the Soviet Union, I watched the end of Eastern Europe while living there and writing about it. And both of my books have been an attempt to explain, to go back the clock and explain really originally for myself, how did it get to be that way in the first place? Because if you saw the Soviet Union in the 1980s, as I did, I was a student there, or if you saw Poland in 1989, you saw a system that was falling apart, that nobody believed in, that it even seemed absurd that it could ever work or could ever have worked. Even the people who ran it didn't think that it worked. And of course, in 1989, when I was 20, whatever I was, years old, this seemed very obvious to me. Of course it doesn't work, it's gonna fall apart, that's inevitable. But 20 years later, I think a little bit differently about the period, and I began to wonder, well, if it was so obvious that it would never work, what were the components that put it together in the first place? How did it come to be? And the Gulag was a book about the harshest part period of the Soviet Union, but this book was about what actually did the Soviet Union do when the Red Army arrived in Central Europe in 1945, and it arrived in countries that were very, very different from one another. We've come to assume, now we assume, we understand it's very obvious, of course, Poland is very different from Albania. They have, we don't even think of them really as being in the same category at the time, but in 1989, they all looked very similar. What did the Soviet Union do, between 1945 and 1950 to transform, cosmopolitan Berlin, rural Moldova, industrial Czechoslovakia? What did it do to make them so quickly become these kind of identikit Soviet states? If you had gone to Warsaw or Prague or East Berlin in 1950 and you'd looked around yourself, you would have thought you were seeing places that were identical. Same capital cities, the same parades, the same, slogans, the same kinds of newspapers, sometimes even with the same names, Pravda, this or that. And you would have wanted to, and you would have assumed that that had been a successful revolution. So none of the accounts that I'd read of this period were very satisfying. They almost always focused very exclusively on the politics, this person did that, but they didn't explain what was the social transformation, what was it that the Red Army did to make this thing seem successful, at least for a period of time. And the book was an attempt to answer that. And then there were different answers, but you can...
I just wanted to, before we come on to those, the other thing that struck me when I read it was, how did you do it? It's not just a question of the sheer scale of the historical effort, because there's an extraordinary amount of detail in these books. But I mean, Iron Curtain's got such a lot of detail from different lives. So the practical task of it struck me partly because it wasn't done in one language.
I use translators.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I speak Russian, I speak Polish, and I read them both. And when I was working elsewhere, I worked very closely together with, actually in both cases, they were journalists, with a German journalist and a Hungarian journalist who I literally sat in the archives with, and they would read the document and I would type, and then they would say, and then I would say, well, that's boring, let's go to the next page. And, you know, it was a surprisingly convenient way to work in some ways. But the idea of the book was to, I actually went along looking almost institution by institution. So what happened to the newspapers? What happened to the radio? What happened to the arts? You know, where were the decisions made? And I used a lot of interviews and oral history that had been done by other people as well. But I also used archives, and I worked in all kinds of archives, including secret police archives. I often found that government ministry archives were among the most interesting. You know, so what did the cultural ministry in Poland in 1948 think it was doing? So what were they saying to one another? How were their meetings organized? You know, what did they think they were trying to achieve? And doing that, you know, because they were very good at recording the conversations as they happened, doing that, you found some of it was incredibly revealing. It's revealing because you learn how did they think. One of my favorite ones was the archives of the East German radio I can't remember which year it was, 1948 or 1949. There was a wonderful meeting where the heads of the East German radio station met together, and there's a long protocol of the conversation, which I read through in archives, which are in Potsdam. And the topic of discussion is, why aren't people listening to us? Why are they only listening to Western radio? And in the course of the conversation, it becomes clear that they know why. And one of them even sort of dares to say it. He says, well, you know, our radio programs are very boring, you know. And someone says, well, you know, maybe we need to make them less boring. And somebody says, well, maybe if we put Comrade Ulbricht's speeches on just for, you know, just excerpts from them instead of the whole speech, then it wouldn't be so boring. You know, and then somebody says, no, we need to have the whole 3-hour speech, because if the people aren't listening to everything that Comrade Ulbricht says, then they won't. And you see the awkwardnesses of the system from the very beginning, the strangeness of it, you know, the ways in which it doesn't work. And they know it doesn't work, and they're constantly trying to fix it. You know, it's a process of always trying to make reality fit the theory. You know, in theory, people should be listening to our radio, not West German radio, because our radio is the people's radio, and, you know, we represent the people, and West German radio is capitalist radio, and it's bad and fascist and so on. And so, you know, how do we make reality fit the theory? I sort of worked along the lines of looking through kind of institution by institution, and that's sort of how I came up with the structure of the book.
Well, let me start with the sort of in the beginning, which is the foundational myth of the Soviet relationship with these countries, the question of whether or not these governments arose out of the kind of will of the people, or whether they were a plan introduced by the Soviets. And because I thought your answer to that would be quite simple. And one of the first striking things of the book is the early sections in which you make it clear actually it's a bit more complicated.
Well, there was a long-term plan. And so there's no doubt that Stalin believed, and one of the things you also learn by reading Soviet archives is you eventually learn to take them seriously. So in other words, the ideology is very important. It's not just blah, blah that they say, you know, in order to, you know, please the master or whatever. I mean, they at some level, they believe in it, they use the language. And Stalin, at some level, clearly believed that eventually all of Europe would be communist, because all the world would be communist, because that's what Marx said. And so now it's just a question of how do we get there? How do we get to the moment when the world is communist, and which buttons do we need to push, and what do we need to do? In some places the answer was we're going to move cautiously. You know, the first, you know, we don't want to move too fast. We don't want to scare the horses. We don't want to create too strong a reaction in the West. We need to be careful about who we are. We need to form coalitions, for example. So they begin the communist parties form coalitions with other parties. But it's also very clear that from the beginning, there are certain things they do in every country, including Czechoslovakia, including Poland, including Hungary, including East Germany, which are, you know, absolutely across the board. So everywhere they go, they take over the secret police. They create the secret police, I should say, rather. They, from scratch, they create the secret police. and they begin to use police violence against perceived and interestingly future opponents of the regime. Lenin was a great one for talking about we need to get rid of our future opponents, and this idea is something that the KGB inherited, and first the NKVD and then the KGB inherited as well. You know, we need to identify the young people who might eventually be our opponents sometime now, and we need to persuade them, or we need to arrest them, or we need to deport them, or something. And so they create the secret police. In some cases, the secret police was created before they got there. The Polish secret police, they begin, the origins of it begin in 1939. They begin putting people together from the Western, from the Eastern territories of Poland, which they conquered then, and they begin putting together the police forces at that time. So there's the secret police is absolutely never let out of the communist hands from the beginning. The radio, actually, which I've mentioned already, it's interesting because I started out thinking I'm going to find the newspapers very interesting, and actually they were less interesting because the communists weren't that bothered initially by newspapers and who controlled them. They weren't worried about that. They were worried about radio stations. Who controls that? It's the mass media, because the mass media is the thing that speaks to the workers and peasants, and those are the people who are going to support us. And they didn't sort of initially bother with the intellectuals and, you know, they won't be on our side, but we care about the mass media. So systematically, the secret police, the use of violence, the radio, and the third thing, there are a couple of other things as well, but the third thing that I, again, stumbled upon, not being sure how important it was going to be, are the institutions of what we now call, they weren't called something else then, we now call civil society. So volunteer groups, church groups, and especially youth groups. That's something they cared about right away. So the Soviet soldiers in East Berlin in 1945, you would think they would have a lot to do, right? They would be feeding people. They would be reconstructing the destroyed city. What's one of the first things they begin to do? They worry about hiring kindergarten teachers. This is a sort of task of the Soviet occupation force in the beginning, because they want to have a cadre of kindergarten and primary school teachers in place who are going to begin molding the youth. They care a good deal about youth. But they also care a lot about spontaneous organizations. You know, they want to, and they don't want them to exist. They want all organizations, whether they're chess clubs or soccer clubs or political groups, to be under some kind of state control. And they do this through registration processes. Sometimes they do it through violence. Sometimes they do it through undermining organizations. And this is something, again, they do everywhere. So even in Czechoslovakia, which took a longer time to become sort of fully communist, and even where the pattern was a little bit different, there are a few things they did everywhere and that are interesting because they tell something about how the Soviet secret police thinks, and I think actually to this day think. Their successors.
You said it was the first thing they did. The first thing they did, it seemed to me from your book, was raping everyone. That was a really important thing.
Yes.
So I thought that was a particularly shocking thing, and the book deals with it very well. And also, but it's part of an explanation of how before communism there came a sort of destruction of everything that people had believed in, all the lessons they learned, all the state institutions they'd learned to trust, even faith in their parents. All of those things were kind of wiped out.
That's partly the Red Army. That's also partly the effect of the war. I mean, there's almost no. It's very hard, actually. I think even to talk in a West European city about what happened in Eastern Europe during the war, because it was so much more cataclysmic and so much more catastrophic than anything that happened in the West. The best example of that I know of was I interviewed a quite famous, actually, Polish writer who's now very old, and who later on was a dissident and so on, but who described to me, who was a communist in 1945, Tadeusz Konwicki joined the Communist Party in that year. I asked him, you know, why, and could he talk to me about the circumstances? He said, well, you know, he was, I don't remember if he was 18 or 19 in 1945, he had been brought up in a very patriotic Polish family from near Vilnius, Vilno, in eastern Poland. He'd been brought up as a Catholic. He was a Boy Scout. He was a sort of, you know, patriot who believed in, you know, the system and the country and the regeneration of Poland that happened after 1918. During the war, he joined the resistance. After the war, as the Russians came in, his little resistance unit of the Home Army began to fight the Russians, the Soviet Union. And they did this for a few months and then slowly realized that it was going to fail. They had no support. People wanted the war to be over. There was no, you know, the Allies had drifted away. You know, they were sort of stealing from peasants in order to keep the war going. And they realized it was hopeless. They decided to give up. So age 18 or 19, he put on his backpack and he walked into Poland, you know, a country where actually he'd never been. He'd never been in that part of the Poland. He had no parents. He had no family. He had no home. He had no money. He had only the clothes he was wearing. He had no documents, because, of course, you don't have documents if you're a resistance fighter. And he spent several months drifting around, being completely disoriented. Mm. And he came to the conclusion that everything he'd believed in, everything he was taught, you know, what it had got him, you know, nothing. It was all for nothing. He had a kind of crisis. This Polish state that he'd fought for was weak and had failed, and that for him was the attraction of the Communist Party. This was the new power. You know, it was some people with energy. They were organized. This drew it. So this is somebody who, in another circumstance, had it not been for the war, you know, wouldn't and couldn't have been a communist. But for that brief period, that was. You know, you could see the appeal. And you're absolutely right. This idea that every institution that you know and everything you've been taught has been destroyed may open people up to the possibility of accepting a radical, a very radical new system.
I mean, this leads us on to, what I think is the sort of one of the most surprising things about the book, and also its sort of genius, which is a subtle understanding of people's motivations and a certain degree of sympathy with their dilemmas. And my father, when he was an engineer, a professor, he did quite a lot of work in Eastern and Central Europe, which I often, as a child, I couldn't really understand why he'd done. But he certainly felt that sympathy for people who were in those dilemmas. And tell us a bit about that in your book.
So I tried to, there's a chapter called, I think it's called Reluctant Collaborators, if I remember the book, which I wrote now, you know, a whole 2 years ago. Now, there's a chapter on reluctant collaborators. And what I tried to do in the chapter was explain how it was, because there were a number of real oddities of the system, I should start by saying, when I first began to write it, I did think in very clear categories. You know, there were collaborators and there were resistors, and, you know, these people belong in these. And then I realized, as I read and I spoke to people and I read more deeply into the period, that at some point, even in this very harsh period, it's sometimes very difficult to say who is a collaborator. You know, it was perfectly possible to march in the May Day parade in the morning and then to go home in the afternoon and turn on Radio Free Europe and try and get, you know, Western news. And it was perfectly possible to, you know, go along in the group meeting at your office place, you know, with whatever decision, you know, we're going to sign the petition in favor of peace and against the West, and then to go home in the afternoon and laugh about it with your wife, you know. So it's very complicated to say who was going along with things and why. And I tried to look at what were some people's motivations to collaborate or to not protest. And I find that, you know, we in a Western society or in a democracy where we don't have to make those kinds of choices, we often fail to understand what they are. I mean, these are not people living in 20th century Switzerland where you can do, you know, you can join the party or you cannot join the party and there are no consequences. You know, these are people for whom, joining the party might mean that you have access to an apartment, to medicine for your sick wife. It might mean that your children go to university, whereas otherwise they wouldn't. Very often, in fact, when you begin to think about children, you begin to understand motivations for collaboration. So, you know, what do you want? You want your children to be fed. You want them to go to school. You want them to study. You know, in order to achieve all of those things in a society which has tried to control, you know, which controls all property, which controls all education, which controls all, you know, soccer clubs, very often in order to make it through the day, in order to do the ordinary things that we all consider sort of, you know, normal and important in life, you had to somehow collaborate in some ways. And I began to have some sympathy with some of the people who had managed to do it. There were exceptions, and there were people who were very brave and who resisted or found ways to try to resist, but very often you find that they were either quite young or they were single. I mean, they were often people who, you know, were able for one reason or other to cut ties to others.
It's funny, for exactly the opposite reason. In America, the Communist Party used to discourage its members from either marrying or having children, because the strings made them less easy to send them off on missions and things.
Right. No, I mean, if you want people to do radical things, you know, then it helps if they don't have families. But I mean, my example of that was, you know, tells you something about my range of interest. I was reading through the laws on printing presses. So, you know, at what point did they start to control printing presses and printing books? And this happens in about 1947. In 1947, there's a law passed in East Germany that says, I'm not going to remember the exact language, but it's something like all printing presses all people who own printing presses, they hadn't nationalized them yet, but all people who own printing presses are only allowed to print books and pamphlets which have been agreed by the central plan. That's it. It doesn't say what the consequences are. It doesn't say you'll die, you know, or you'll be murdered for printing. That's it. That's the law. And then you think about, you know, your printer in Dresden, you know, after the war. You have, you know, your house burned in the firebombing of Dresden. You know, your wife is in the hospital. Your cousin was arrested last week and has disappeared somewhere into Siberia. You know, you have two children who you want to have study. How likely is it, if in that position, that you will make the brave decision to print some opposition leaflet that's not in the central plan, or anything really that's not in the central plan? What good will that do you? You know, it could mean you lose your press, you lose your house, your wife loses her medicine, your children get kicked out of school. You know, the consequences are diabolical. On the other hand, if you do print, say, you know, the memoirs of Comrade Stalin, as many people did, how does that hurt you, really? I mean, if you don't print it, somebody else will print it. I mean, it's not a... And many of the dilemmas that communism in particular presented with people didn't seem like life or death dilemmas. You know, you weren't necessarily being asked to betray your country or inform on your wife, you know, at least not initially. You were being asked to just print, you know, the books that this party has asked you to print. And those don't seem like important decisions, and many people would go along with them. I mean, the system was diabolical in that way, in that it often, you know, the collaboration often happened through very small and ordinary decisions rather than big, dramatic ones. Mm-hmm. Different from Nazism.
You give the church the sort of two cardinals as your one of your big examples, Wyszynski and Mindszenty.
So I talked about, I mean, I looked at a lot of different examples of how people got along in the system. And one of them I looked at were the two most important churchmen of the period. One is, as you say, Cardinal Wyszynski was the leader of the Polish primate at that time, and Cardinal Mindszenty was the primate of Hungary. And both of them are very similar in their backgrounds. They're both from provincial backgrounds. They're both, you know, real patriots. They're both men who cared a great deal about their countries. You can't really call either one of them a collaborator in any way. But faced with very similar kind of pressure, because one of the things that happened to the church was initially left alone. It was a lot more dangerous to be a church youth group leader in 1947 than to be a priest. They were much more worried about the organizations around the church they originally wanted to just leave the church. The church, we're not going to mess with that. It's just for old people and they'll die off, and, you know, no need to hurry with the church. And then later in 47 and 48, they became much more concerned about it because people did still see it as a source of alternative values, and indeed would until the very end. And there begins to be a very severe crackdown on the church, arrests of priests, dissolution of church organizations, church charities are dissolved, nationalization of church property, and real pressure on the hierarchy, the leaders of the church, to conform, to sign bits of paper, and so on. And the two cardinals, in that circumstance, reacted in very different ways. And the account of them is not intended to say one was right and one was wrong. Although, actually, I was just in Hungary talking about this book, and the Hungarians were desperate for me to get into an argument about who was right. It was really not about that. It was just an attempt to show how two very brave people did very different things. And so Mindszenty very famously became a sort of loud, open, committed anti-communist. And he spoke up, and he called for help from the Vatican, and he protested, and he organized protests in Hungary. And I mean, some of you know the story. He was eventually arrested. He was beaten very badly in prison. He was tortured. He was put on a show trial, eventually under arrest. Then later on, he played a role in 1956. He was let out. But he became a symbol of you know, really strong anti-communist opposition. The Hungarian church did not necessarily benefit from that. I mean, it was very badly destroyed and undermined in that period. Wyszynski did something completely different, which is that he tried to find a modus operandi. He tried to find ways to get along. He signed some kind of church-state agreement with the communists. He tried to protect people. He tried to save the priests. He spoke a lot about, and he wrote in his diaries at the time and later, about how badly the Polish church had suffered during the war, how many priests had died, and he wanted to preserve their lives and somehow preserve the church and keep it going. And at the time, he was criticized as a sort of collaborator. You know, look, why isn't he standing up? Why isn't he shouting louder and so on? But he did in the end he wasn't put in prison, but he was under house arrest. But he was eventually let out, and the Polish church actually survived in a somewhat better state than the Hungarian church. Had an advantage of being a church of the whole nation, whereas Hungary is divided between Catholics and Protestants. But the idea was is that there's no right or wrong answer in when you're under that kind of pressure. You know, it can be very brave to speak out. It can also be very brave not to. You know, it can be very brave to try and protect people, to try and keep something going, to try and make sure that the institution itself survives.
Given what you now know, would you regard Yalta as a betrayal then of you know, where basically of the values of the war? Did the Allies end up sort of surrendering really to sort of half the problem they were trying to fight?
I think there's no question that they did that, but I think it's also very important to put it in context. You know, what Yalta says to me and what it says to many people in Eastern Europe now is simply that if you look and if you read the Yalta, you know, the protocols of the meetings, which you now can, you know, the English version and the American version and the Russian version are all accessible, it becomes absolutely clear that for the Western Allies, for the Anglo-Americans, Eastern Europe is simply not a priority. You know, Roosevelt goes to Yalta, and there are two things he wants to achieve. Number one, he wants to make sure that the United Nations comes together and is created after the war and the Russians take part of it. And number two, he wants Soviet help in the American war on Japan. And those are his two priorities. And you can even controversially say that from Roosevelt's point of view, Yalta was a great success because he achieved the two things that he wanted. Churchill, who understood very well what was happening in Eastern Europe, not least because the exile governments were all in London, was perhaps even slightly more cynical. I mean, because he knew what was happening. He already had a sense from the polls of as the Red Army came into Poland, what was happening. But again, for him, you know, the priority was end the war quickly, lose as few British lives as possible, preserve the empire. I mean, the priority was not create a free Poland after the war. And you see that, and I hope an important lesson to people from those countries about self-reliance and about, you know, what you can expect from faraway allies. Because it's crystal clear that this just wasn't what they were trying to achieve.
Have you got some idea, though, how much sacrifice would have been necessary to do something about it? Because, I mean, obviously one of the big arguments for Yalta is, it would have basically required a war with Stalin to do anything about it, and that was just not on the cards. So
the only way you could have done it differently is if the Allies had been fighting the war differently from the beginning. In other words, if one of the goals of the war, of the fighting, was to prevent Stalin from occupying as much of Europe as, you know, to keep him as far out of Europe as possible. You know, in other words, if Eisenhower had liberated Prague rather than Stalin. You know, if we had raced to Berlin to get there before the Russians, which we absolutely didn't, you know, we made a decision not to do. If the war had been fought with that as one of the goals in mind from 1943, not at the very end, then yes, I think you could have had a different outcome. But that was never one of the goals. You know, it wasn't really until the very end. It wasn't until 1945 when Churchill begins to see what's happening, and when Truman, you know, Truman arrives in office and is shocked by what's just happened because he hasn't been informed about what the Soviet Union is doing in Eastern Europe, and they arrive, you know, and then there is a sort of realization, oh no, what's happened? Half of Europe is occupied, but you would have had to think of it earlier, and they didn't.
In terms of the motivation for the hegemony, and this is going to lead on to questions about now. To what extent was it ideological? Because you said that lots of the language was ideological. And to what extent was it nationalistic? In other words, the Russians took the view that the Ukraine was in its zone of interest and it would be dangerous to allow a government that was unsympathetic to form there. So it was a sort of defensive position. Or to what extent was it an ideological position? This is an area that's fallen into our zone of influence because it has no government and we want to impose one that reflects the people's revolution.
I don't think you can separate it. I mean, the Stalin didn't see the world and, you know, now I'm going to be cynical and idealistic and cynical and nationalistic right now and then tomorrow, you know, those weren't separate goals in his mind. You know, his goals were the expansion of the Soviet Union and of the Soviet sphere of influence, which meant the spread of Marxist-style, Soviet-style governments. You know, the only people who will ever be really loyal to us are people who have our system. And our system is the one which, you know, those are the people. There's a Polish joke, actually, about what's the definition of a safe Soviet border? And the answer is, that's a border with Soviet soldiers on both sides of it. You know, I mean, that was the, you know, we need our system to be imposed as far as it can be possible, and you know, that's how we'll keep pushing our system out into the rest of the world. And I don't think there was, in his mind, any separation between those two things. They were the same thing. I know it's hard. This is very hard for the Westerners to understand because often, you know, their language was so, it sounded so ritualistic and formal, you know, particularly late in the later years, in the 70s and 80s. But when you read in this period, that, you know, it's clear that this is what they think. They think that our protection of our national interests means the expansion of communism. There's no line drawn.
Let's bring that to now, because one of the things that interests me, obviously, is the fact that when you go to Moscow, you know, you can still see Stalin's statue in Red Square. And they've still got that.
Next to the wall. Apparently, they're about to rename. They may be about to rename Volgograd, Stalingrad again.
Yeah. And they've got that idiot Lenin still on display. And so, it seems to me that they haven't actually come to terms with their own past. And I suppose some of your and what it really was about, and some of your writing is, I suppose, an attempt to acquaint them with that. Has it had much of a reading in?
It's a very complicated story. I mean, it's even, you know, there was a moment. So there are two separate issues. There was a moment in the late 1980s. This is the moment of perestroika, glasnost, really, not perestroika, when there was a kind of tremendous Russian interest in and Soviet ex-Soviet interest in the Soviet past. I don't know what. Well, Soviet interest in the Soviet past, as they were still the Soviet Union. And there was a flowering of literature, and there were enormous, you know, newspapers with accounts of the Gulag would sell out a million copies. You know, there really was a kind of burst of interest and a lot of history, and Solzhenitsyn returned to the country, and there was a great discussion in the late 1980s. It was followed very rapidly by the collapse of the economy in the 1990s. And this will sound, it sounds an odd connection, but in many Russians' minds, and this has been reinforced by Putin and by his account of that period, there is a connection. In other words, we had all that discussion about the past, and all it did was weaken our country, and it weakened our resolve, and it, you know, that helped destroy our economy, and then we became weak and powerless, and, you know, the people's wages weren't being paid on time. And once we stopped having all that conversation about the past and we moved on with a more positive story, then we were able to rebuild the country. And I've just simplified it a good deal. But there is an Putinism, and there is now a kind of ideology of Putinism, which is not just nationalism, has a theory of history. And it has, in particular, a theory of the last 25 years. And one of the elements of that is that, you know, this discussion of weakness and tragedy was very bad for us, and we mustn't have it anymore. I mean, that's, you know, it's a little bit more nuanced than that, because, you know, they pick and choose which bits of the Stalinist past are okay to talk about and which not. And there is a certain amount of, there is some acknowledgement that the Gulag happened. There's no denial of it. But they don't dwell on it.
Just elaborate on what Putinism is as distinct to nationalism, because that's an intriguing thing, thought.
That's a whole separate lecture.
Okay, little taste.
No, I mean, Putinism is a kind of theory of power that Putin developed. And actually, sometimes I get asked this, and it's not unrelated to the themes of this book. Putinism, you know, how do you rule a country, when you're not the legitimate leader, which are the institutions that you try to control? It's all shifted a little bit in the last year or two. But the first two terms of Putinism, he tried to run Russia very much along the lines of the way the communists tried to, not so, it was a little bit different from the Soviet Union. It was more like how the communists tried to run Eastern Europe. In other words, control the mass media, control what we call civil society, which has always been very important for the KGB. Maintain hold of the secret police and use not mass violence, but selective violence. This was a very, very important in this period and very important later on. So we don't kill all the journalists. This isn't the 1930s. We don't send everybody to the Gulag. We kill one journalist. You know, we kill Anna Politkovskaya, and that scares everybody else. And that's very much a technique from this period. You can almost see Putin. I mean, and, you know, I can't prove this, but there is a connection, which is that Putin was a great admirer. The head of the KGB when he joined it was Yuri Andropov. Yuri Andropov was the Soviet ambassador to Budapest in 1956. And Yuri Andropov became, after that experience of seeing the Hungarian Revolution break out, and the Hungarian Revolution literally begins with little grouplets of students talking about Hungarian history, and then the students go and meet the workers, and then there's a you know, chaos on the streets, and they're hanging Soviet soldiers, and they've got out the tanks. And that experience of Andropov's led him to be almost hyper-conscious about the control of intellectual debate and the control of civil society and the control of the media, which I think Putin has inherited. I mean, I don't yet have the protocols of the meeting where Putin is sitting listening to Andropov say this and so on, but, you know, someday we'll have that.
Let me just, because I need to have everyone else ask questions, let me just finish with, I'm afraid, a bit of a broad gauge question, but I want to know how the insights of this book and your previous one have informed your understanding of what's now happening in Ukraine.
What's now happening in Ukraine? So when this invasion of Crimea first began, I almost had the feeling of, you know, first of all, I wish I'd seen this before I wrote my book, because now I understand 1945 better. And second of all, was this feeling of just extraordinary deja vu. So what did the Russians do? I mean, first in Crimea and now in eastern Ukraine, they sent in, you know, Secret Service operatives who, I mean, in this case, they weren't playing with, you know, massive war damage and psychologically damaged people in the way they were in 1945. But certainly, for example, in eastern Ukraine, you know, they go in, and who are they looking? Who is attracted to them? There's young men from criminal classes, people discontented with the system. Who are they able to attract? It's exactly those are the kinds of people who became the Polish secret policemen in 1945. Kind of the same class of discontented young, mostly male, often semi-criminal men. I mean, the way in which the so-called separatists in Donetsk have been formed, the way in which these committees in Crimea were formed, is very, very similar to the way the takeover happened in 1945. I mean, I've had this argument about whether it's 1945 or 1939 or 1940, because there was a similar kinds of invasions happened in 39 in eastern Poland and then 40 in the Baltic states. And you can sort of quibble about to which is it more similar. But the technique of using, having a plan in advance, using Secret Service operatives, special forces, in small numbers, but who are designed to attract discontented people around them, supplying them with weapons in increasing numbers. This is something that's been done before. I mean, it's very, very, very similar.
And what does it lead you to think can be done about it?
Well, I mean, you aren't dealing with a totally devastated wartime landscape, you know, in a world which is completely distracted by many other things at the same time. And you also, you know, Ukraine of 2014 is not the destroyed, you know, leaderless country that Poland was in 1945. I mean, Ukraine is a real country. It now has probably the best group of leaders in power that it's had in, you know, in 2.5 decades. It has, it's beginning to have a much stronger sense of nationhood and a clear place of its own, idea of its own role in Europe and its own sort of civilizational identity. And it is now something that, you know, Kiev is a pole of attraction for people in a way that, you know, there was no such thing in Poland or in Hungary in 1945, and there was no alternative thing to join. And so Eastern Ukraine is not, you know, the Russians don't have control of everything in the way they could in 1945. They're competing against an alternate vision of Ukraine, which, you know, isn't guaranteed to win, but has a chance. It's not the same landscape of total devastation, I would say it that way.
Okay, well, I reluctantly have to let everyone else ask questions, because I was enjoying asking them myself. Who would like to start?
You gave one throwaway line. You said that Stalin was assuming that at some point Western Europe would be communist because he assumed that the whole world would be communist because Marx had said so. And I just wonder, do you think that is what Stalin actually thought? I mean, he was the champion of socialism in one country, and, you know, he was at the apex of this total control apparatus in the Soviet Union. Well, I wonder if he, you know, if it was not a bit more cynical than that, I mean, if he was just pleased to set up his buffer states and to protect his socialist empire, and maybe Marx was something he believed in his youth, but by then, was he just a cynical palmonger?
It's important to understand the difference between strategy and tactics. You know, so long-term strategy for Stalin never changes. And there are documents that they wrote during the war. There's a famous one. There's a foreign ministry produces a document about what Europe will look like over the next 20 years, and it describes the countries which are likely to become communist and how long will it take. And they reckon Britain, I think, will take at least 25 years before the workers' movement can overthrow the system. You know, that's a harder problem. They do continue to talk like that all the way through. I mean, you can maybe by the 70s, they stop really believing things. And certainly by the very end, nobody believes anything. But in this period, they still very much speak that. You remember that Stalin was part of the first foreign policy act that the Bolsheviks did after taking power in 1918? They invaded Poland in 1920. And, you know, they were stopped and they expected to win that, and they expected to move quickly from Poland into Germany, which was their real interest. And they expected to win that war because they thought that the Polish peasants and workers would rise up and join them, you know, and that didn't happen, which they were very bitter about, and they blame the backwards Polish aristocracy for having stopped them, you know, from this. But it was actually after that defeat that there's this first change in foreign policy, and then they announce, okay, we're going to do socialism in one country, but that was always meant to be temporary. And the foreign policy of the Soviet Union from the beginning was always about fomenting revolution, planting communist parties, at what point will the moment be good for the revolution in country X or Y? And yes, of course, it's true that over time, as that became increasingly unlikely, it becomes more cynical. But in this period, they had, there were training camps for communists in the Soviet Union during the war. There are wonderful stories about who met who at them, and I have some of that in the book. Then they had German communists, they had Polish communists, they also had French communists, they had Italian communists, they had Spanish communists, and all of them were meant to go back to their countries after the war and, you know, foment revolution. And many of them tried. You know, we forget how close, you know, it came in Italy or France. Italy or France very well could have been communist countries after the war. The reason it happened and was successful in Eastern Europe was because of the presence of the NKVD and the Red Army, who were there to supply the violence and to supply the organization and the guys with you know, the equivalent of today's guys with walkie-talkies and rifles in Ukraine. I mean, the special forces operators who were able to organize on the ground. But I, you know, certainly at this time, certainly in the 1940s and 1950s, this was still very real. It's very much part of the foreign policy conversation. It's what they talk about when, you know, when they talk about France, that's what they talk about. They talk about, you know, how long will it take for the revolution to happen? Maybe later they lose it.
So Stalin personally was still a true believer on his deathbed in 1953 or whatever it was.
I mean, yeah. What does it mean to be a true believer? I mean, yes. He believed in the theory as he interpreted it. I mean, it was, remember that Marxism is, I mean, it's, you know, Marxist-Leninism, I should say, because Marxism is a narrower thing, was a theory of power as much as a theory of economics. You know, Marxist-Leninism was an idea about how you keep and hold power and how you promote power and how you spread power. And I think he believed in that a lot. And he famously read and reread Marx and read and reread Lenin. He's all of his copies of the books with his annotations in them are kept somewhere. You can read them if you apply to the right person in the Russian archives. I mean, he was reading it and rereading it and thinking about it, and then, of course, interpreting it in his own way. I mean, I'm not saying that he was all of his life interested in the welfare of the poorest and how to, I mean, I'm not sure that was his goal, but his goal was reinterpreting this body of thought for his own ends, and that is what he did.
And can I ask something from this?
Sure.
Is there a case to be made for the civil society in Czechoslovakia having been stronger, more tight-knit, than in the other countries, because, as you said, in Czechoslovakia, it took much longer for the Sovietization.
No, the country that wound up with the strongest and most coherent counter civil society, in other words, that the civil society that was able to counter communism was Poland. I mean,
coalescing around the church.
Was, yeah,
and
I mean,
around.
So you could argue that. By the 80s. You know, all of these countries tried in different ways to fight back or to reorganize, particularly after. So my book describes the worst, earliest, most violent period of communist occupation. It did change after that. It changes very much after Stalin dies. And there begin to then be attempts to reorganize society, to put back together the sort of broken pieces. And they have different strengths at different times. I mean, you know, 1956 is very much the product of Hungarians pulling themselves back together again. The country that in 1989, 1990 has the most coherent civic institutions and civic structures is, you know, alternate non-communist ones is Poland. So exactly when, I mean, you know, Czechoslovakia, we're talking about differences of a couple. Czechoslovakia became kind of fully communist in 1948, whereas the others, you could argue, it happened a little earlier. It's not a big difference in time.
The gentleman over there.
And absolutely fascinating. Ronnie Guy, it reminds me of Churchill's exhortation that we can all study history to understand not only what's going on now, but what will happen in the future. I was a Cold War warrior. We used to say frequently that we could judge the Soviet army's capabilities very precisely. What we had great difficulty doing was working out what their intentions were. And I want to pull you back to sort of today, as I was doing, and what is going on in Putin's mind and how this plays out. Because it looks as if, now we have the added complication, of course, in Iraq, it looks as if the Americans are having to wake up about how they position themselves. For example, Obama's speech in Poland was very interesting, I thought.
And, it was a very good speech.
And he was demonstrating that maybe, pushed by people in the Pentagon, there was a wake-up call and that NATO was going to have to start to do something. Where does Putin take all this? And is he perhaps riding on an artificially inflated economy that will collapse?
Well, you've just given sort of three separate subjects there. You know, artificially economy to the side, or inflated economy. I think your main point is absolutely right, that the events in Ukraine, and particularly the Crimean annexation, which was a new move, surprised the West a good deal. And there was and has caused a rethinking of the relationship with Russia of a kind that maybe should have happened earlier. Maybe should have been sparked by the invasion of Georgia. You know, maybe should have been, you know, would have become, but never mind why it didn't happen earlier. It has happened now. I mean, I said to somebody who was there talking about the, you know, the very first conversations, when there first began to be conversations about sanctions on Russia a couple of months ago. Somebody who was part of that conversation, I said, well, you know, this is very weak, you know, you're sanctioning one or two people, you know, it's like, he said to me, you know, you have no idea, you know, for the Portuguese or the Spanish or, you know, the Irish to come down to a table and start talking about sanctions on Russia is a kind of Copernican revolution. You know, nobody had thought in those terms in 30 years, and nobody wanted it. I mean, to this day, nobody wants to think in those terms. You know, people had got used to the idea of an integrated Russia, and people had got used to the, it's really an American narrative, but became a European narrative about how, you know, we are going to embrace Russia, Russia's eventually going to become a Western country. You know, Russia had been treated like a sort of junior Western partner, sort of difficult partner, maybe junior partner, but who would eventually grow up and become one of us and join our institutions. That's why they were in the G8, that's why they were in the Council of Europe, and so on. And this was the moment that ended that particular narrative. That's sort of over, for better or for worse. And I think the understanding that Russia is not, you know, going to be a member of the West, that it's actually an anti-Western power that has different set of interests and is playing a different game, I think that's now sunk in for the first time. I mean, the next question is, and that's rather amazing that it happened. The next question is, what do we do about it, and will we? You know, how do we begin to think strategically about that, how that should affect where NATO troops are stationed, how it should affect our European, you know, the European gas industry, how it affects how we negotiate with Russia. You know, shouldn't we be negotiating over gas, for example, as Europe and not as country by country, not allowing Russia to do separate deals. There are all kinds of ways in which we can begin to think strategically about, I mean, again, not so much about countering Russia or defeating Russia, but just dealing with the fact that we have a very large power on our borders, which wishes to undo our system. I mean, the annexation of Crimea was a demonstration that it was Putin saying to us, you know, all the things that you think about post-war Europe, you know, your borders are safe, you know, there will never be a war in Europe again. You know, all the rules, the post-war rules, the post-1991 agreed deals, it's all up in the air. I don't believe any of it anymore. And him having done that means that we need to rethink what's our relationship with a country, and things like that. I mean, and that process is just beginning. And although there's some positive things about it, I mean, yes, you're right. The United States will now be very distracted by Iraq, and others will be distracted by other things, and the temptation to return to business as usual will be strong. But I think the awareness that there's been a major shift in Russia, it's, you know, which has actually been taking place over 10 years and not in the last 6 months, but I think now the awareness has sunk in a deeper way. So I think policy making will be, at least, you know, rhetorically, and I hope in other ways, different.
There's a question right at the back. Yes.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to ask, do you have any opinions on the current day-to-day narrative reporting in the English language media, which you think is particularly good, or, for instance, is being missed? And on the...
Which English media is good? We have several representatives of the English media in this room, so I'll just say nice things about that.
Your views...
Here's the Economist.
Do you mean foreign affairs or...
Of Ukraine.
On Russia, the current Russian-Ukrainian situation, and also whether there are any particular strengths or things being missed on the commentary and the analysis on those.
Right. Well, there are a number of. We have the Economist here. In full force. We have the Times, so I have to be careful. I have to be careful what I say.
I'm a subscriber to both.
Excellent.
Excellent.
We support both very heavily. So. I think it's changed a little bit, actually. I think the initial, there was a very weird initial moment following the invasion of Crimea when I think the British, not only the British press, actually, but everybody in Britain and many elsewhere, you know, across Europe, found the story very confusing and hard to understand. And I think it's still confusing. And I think that's partly because it's deliberately confusing. You know, in a way, this is a kind of postmodern war. You know, this wasn't an invasion with 40,000 troops and, you know, shock and awe bombing and, you know, the kind of thing that we've got used to seeing in the last 20 years. This was a very subtle, you know, 1945 style invasion with, you know, a few people moving weapons overnight, quite a lot of decoys, quite a lot of people playing double roles. And it was also accompanied by a propaganda barrage from Russia of a kind I had not seen before in 20 years. Certainly nothing I'd seen in the last two decades coming out of Russia. It was almost the Goebbels theory that if you tell one lie and it's big enough that, you know, everybody will eventually have to at least cope with that. And there was simply saying black is white coming out of the Russian, both Russian politicians and Russian diplomats, but also the Russian media, confused people quite a bit, and I think still do. There's an odd thing, you know, the British press is actually a very fair and judicious press a lot of the time. And there's a long tradition, kind of BBC tradition of giving both sides a fair hearing, right? So on the one hand, you know, we need to hear what the Ukrainian government is saying. On the other hand, we need to hear what the Russian government is saying. And then the British assumption will be, well, then the truth must lie somewhere in the middle. You know, there's some, I think somebody, I think it was Jonathan Friedland, actually wrote an article with that headline. You know, the truth must be in the middle. The Russian government says the Ukrainians are Nazis. The Ukrainians say the Russians are invading. Well, there must be some truth on both sides. You know, that's it. And in that sense, Russian propaganda was quite effective in that it created the idea that there was this alternative view and that it was based on reality, just like the other view. And, you know, it was our job as kind of neutral outsiders to weigh and balance both sides. And the fact that one side was lying made it a lot harder to understand. But I think there's been some very good reporting. I mean, maybe it's because I'm, you know, reading it, but I mean, I seek out the good reporters and I follow them, but there's some very good, particularly British reporters who've been writing about it. So I'm not in total despair about the press. Yeah. Some people.
I was particularly interested by what you said about the focus on young people, educating young people, kindergarten teachers and so on. Today, the youth of Russia is being educated in the public schools of Britain. So, so I suppose two questions. What is the impact of that likely to be, and is it the worst possible thing we can do to cut off some of the people who are sending their children to these schools because we're perhaps destroying the best propaganda machine that we've got?
So I have to be really careful here. So I have some personal acquaintance with some children of Russian oligarchs studying in British schools, and I won't name any names. And it's you know, first of all, the answer, I tried to write about this not that long ago. I tried to interview some of the various wives and exactly being interested in this story. This generation, I mean, it's not very many people, actually. I mean, it's in the few thousands rather than the millions. So what would happen to these kids who were brought up here and in Switzerland and in Paris as well and a few other places? What would happen to this generation of Russians being brought up abroad? And it's complicated. Some of them... some of them do learn to play cricket and so on. A lot of them do develop a kind of defensiveness. You know, here we are in this, you know, in this British surrounding, you know, by people who, you know, none of you understand us. And there is a phenomenon of, this is for older children, not children, but young adults. There is a phenomenon at some British universities. I encountered at the LSE when I taught there a couple of years ago. There are Russian students who come here saying, we come here in order to, you know, take whatever economic knowledge we have. You know, we hate the West. We hate you. You're all lying about us. And we're going to go back to Russia and build it. So there's a sort of pro-Putin group of Russian students here as well. You know, there is also this very long tradition of really crazy radicals studying at the LSE, you know, Pol Pot. You know. I mean, third, you know, sort of people from Cambodia and from African countries coming to study in Britain, winding up hating Britain, becoming very anti-Western and sort of going back to their own countries and, you know, fomenting revolutions against the British. So you have to be very careful about what will happen, making generalizations about the children.
There are quite a lot of people who stayed here and did that.
Quite a lot of people who stayed here and did that.
I went to the LSE, by the way. That's the reason.
You know, but... So, You know, the more interesting question is what is happening to young Russians inside Russia? And that's a little bit up in the air. I mean, it seems to vary a lot from school to school and region to region. Putin has belatedly become interested in organizing young people and in creating. They've tried to create a, made several attempts actually to create kind of, you know, nashi or sort of groups of young pro-Putin or pro-Russian kind of nationalist groups that are somehow under government control. And it hasn't ever really taken, actually. I mean, it has never been a big success, and it's never become a mass movement. And on the contrary, there's quite a lot of evidence that Russian young people are quite alienated and, you know, angry, just like teenagers everywhere else. So maybe the hope lies in them. We'll see.
Unfortunately, I have got very long. I'm going to take these two questions with the hands up, one there and one there. Please.
2 weeks ago, Poland celebrated its first...
I'm sorry?
2 weeks ago, Poland celebrated its first democratic elections. Today, we're talking about transitions. I'm just wondering, based on your learning from a very distant past, judging how we transition from communism into democracy, is it the case that perhaps Poland or other Eastern European countries should have been more radical in cutting ties off? How do you assess how well we dealt with the past?
That's an interesting conversation. I mean, it's one of these things where I don't think there are rules that apply to every country. And in fact, the more you look at the way, you know, the different ways in which countries have found to deal with the legacy of totalitarianism or authoritarianism, the more you realize that it really has to be suited to the country. I was once at an event at Yale run by the Yale Global something, Global Seminar, I don't remember. And actually, I went, it was after my other book came out, and I went and made a little speech. I was asked to speak to this group of, I think it was 25-year-old, 30-year-old people from everywhere. There were about 40 of them. And I spoke about Russia and this issue of dealing with the past and the gulag and what do people know about it and so on. And then, you know, one woman raised her hand and she says, well, I'm from Argentina, and, you know, we have a very similar issue there. And then somebody said, well, I'm from Mexico, and we have some issues there. And somebody said, well, I'm from Zimbabwe. And we went around the room, and actually it turned out that almost every single country, you know, then somebody from Australia said, well, we've had a problem with the Aborigines. I mean, there was almost no country in which there was not some piece of trauma in the past to deal with. I mean, when you think about it, the U.S. civil rights movement was the United States' belated attempt to deal with the legacy of slavery. You know, in some ways, that or some of those arguments still go on. Poland's solution, which was essentially not to talk about it for a long period of time, which at the time I was very opposed to, and I had advantages and disadvantages. So the Poles didn't speak much about the immediate past immediately. Later on, they did. Now there's a very open historical discussion and debate and so on. But they didn't do the German thing of opening all the archives. And they didn't have truth and reconciliation commissions like the South Africans. And they were they stayed, for the first decade, there was a lot of silence about, you know, who had done what in the communist period. The advantage of that was the old communist elite accepted the new system. And they, not only that, they accepted it and they began to play by its rules. And they the former communists formed a new political party. They called themselves, you know, Social Democrats, but everybody knew they were the former communists, and they're still called that to this day. They formed a new political party. They contested for power. They actually won an election. And they essentially worked, you know, they supported the new system and, you know, accepted its values and became part of it. There was no violence, there was no resistance, there was no serious attempt, I should say, to undermine the state. There were many advantages of that kind of that decision. There were some disadvantages. One of them was there developed a feeling of unfairness. You know, we had this transition, the bad guys didn't get punished. You know, not all the good guys won. Some of the bad guys took over property and became rich. It's unfair. And this feeling that the transition was unfair continues to be a kind of counter-narrative, and it's almost a problem in Polish politics that remains unresolved to this day. You know, you can argue it either way. Some of what's happening in Iraq right now is the you know, represents the failure of that of the immediate post-war, post-Saddam state to cope with the legacies of Baathism and the role of the Sunnis. You know, there was an attempt to just say, the Americans decided, no, we're going to destroy that old state and replace it with something else, and that was turned out to not be the right way forward. I mean, you can there are different ways to balance it in different places. You know, Chile made a similar decision to Poland. Initially, the deal was Pinochet hands over power. We don't punish him. You know, we don't do courts. Instead, he and the people around him are going to accept the new system and work with it, and that held for quite a long time. And there again, there were many advantages to doing that and many disadvantages. And there are people who feel a sense of injustice to this day. Poland has had a very similar kind of sort of negotiated transition. But there are advantages and disadvantages to both.
Let's just have one last brief question and answer.
Thank you. Just going back to the last question but one, or your answer to it, could you give us some idea what support Putin had? I mean, if he didn't look both ways before he crossed the road and died, what difference would that make to Russian policy now?
That's a complicated question because polling is always difficult in an authoritarian country. And there's a complication with Russian polling, which is this has been true for 10 years. You know, if you ask people, do you approve of Putin, they will often say yes. If you then say, do you like the way that your city is run, they will say no, it's a disaster. How one interprets that is complicated. What it leads me to believe is that his support, to the extent that it exists and you can show it in polling, we don't know really whether he has any support because elections are manipulated in Russia. So he hasn't been elected, we know that, and he hasn't been freely elected. And whatever support he does have might be very shallow. In other words, as is so often the case in autocracies, they appear very strong on the surface and they're very weak underneath. Democracy is usually the other way around, where democracies appear to be very weak, but actually the system is quite strong. I think the biggest question, and I don't know the answer to this, although there might be people in the room who think they do, but is what the people immediately around Putin think of him, what the inner circle, what Russia's wealthy elite thinks, and that I hear different versions. There are many people who fear that the direction he's going, the Crimean annexation, the war in eastern Ukraine, is stretching relations with the West, is beginning to harm Russia's business interests. And I think it's actually unequivocal. There's no question that it has harmed Russia's business interests. I mean, maybe not as much as some people would have liked, but the sanctions had an effect, if not, you know, in a dramatic way on the Russian economy, they had an effect on the way people are thinking about investing in Russia. They've had an effect on Russians, you know, wealthy Russians themselves. There's a lot of evidence of people moving money out of the country. And the question is, at what point will that level of discontent, you know, lead people to believe they need to change leadership? And that remains to be seen.
Well, that was a tremendous exposition. I just wanted to add one thing, because we discussed it before. If anybody doesn't have a copy of this book already and wishes to have one and does actually have a few, which...
15.
For £15, I'm sure she'll also sign it, which we... It's arranged it not because it's a selling opportunity, but because we thought after we'd spoken about it, some people would feel they wanted to have one, and there are actually some in the building, so we thought we'd make that available.
But could I also say thank you very much to our guest, Danny, for drawing out all the themes of moral ambiguity and the importance of a strong civil society, and above all, the importance of those Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts who are obviously the pawns of democracy or
there's a whole chapter on Boy Scouts. It was a major concern of the communist leaderships is what do we do about the Boy Scouts and how do we make sure that they become communist Boy Scouts? But anyway, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.